Chanda Rule from Austria. Isn't she great? They were wonderful. Very peaceful, isn't it? Today we're looking at the 7th and 8th verse from the Tao Te Ching, that sacred book that was written 2,500 years ago, 500 years before Jesus. We're looking at the chapters from Dyer's book, Living Beyond the Ego and Living in the Flow. Now, have you ever said to somebody or thought about somebody, boy, does she have a big ego? Anybody ever done that? Oh, yeah. Oh, boy, does he have a big ego. Well, here's the deal. We all have an ego, don't we? We all have an ego. Hence the name of the chapter, Living Beyond the Ego. We all have an ego. And guess what? People had an ego 2,500 years ago, too, from the beginning of time. And Lao Tzu recognizes this in the 7th verse. Heaven is eternal. The earth endures. Why do heaven and earth last forever? They do not live for themselves only. This is the secret of their durability. For this reason, the sage puts himself last and so ends up ahead. He stays a witness to life, so he endures. Serve the needs of others, and all your own needs will be fulfilled. Through selfless action, fulfillment is attained. Interesting, right? Why does heaven and earth endure? Lao Tzu saying, because it gives to life. It gives. It's always giving. That's why it endures. And Lao Tzu's telling us that's what the sage does. The sage thinks in terms of giving, like the Tao. Isn't the Tao always giving us? It's giving us oxygen, it's beating our heart, it gives us nature, it gives us food, it gives us air, it gives us water, it gives us creative ideas. It's always giving of itself. I remember Mother Teresa, I quoted her last week too. She said, if you want to experience God, you got to give as God gives. Love as God loves. Be in joy as God is. Enjoy. That is living beyond the ego. And we might wonder, why do we need to be reminded about that? Why do we need to be encouraged to give? Why did Jesus say, as you give, you receive? Why do we need to be reminded of that? You know, one of the probably the biggest reason is because human beings have been conditioned to think that our fulfillment and our happiness comes from outside. If I could just have a little more of something else, then I'll be fulfilled. Then I'll be content. If I had more money, then I would be secure. And yet if you look at millionaires, multimillionaires, they're just as worried and concerned about money as everybody else. Worried about losing it, worried about investing, worry about, you know, it's just a human thing, worry. Looking outside, if I could just have this or that, then I'll be happy. That's how we've been conditioned. And the other thing is that we do, we're constantly trying to get what we think is going to make us happy and fulfilled or secure or safe or whatever. And we are trying to avoid that which frightens us. We try to avoid things that we don't like based on experiences of the past. It's like somebody who, you know, had a bad relationship with somebody named Bill or Frank, whatever. And now, whenever they hear that name Frank, oh, Frank. Hey, would you like to go on a blind date? Oh, blind date? That sounds good. Yeah. What's his name? Frank. Oh, no, no. I don't want to go out with anybody named Frank. Uh-uh, no. We might laugh, but what we're saying is that experiences of the past have affected us. And a lot of people are living their lives trying to avoid those things that stir up the stuff that they never dealt with from the past. So that's, if we're spending our life trying to get stuff to make us happy and fulfilled, some are going after power, status, money, whatever it is. Wayne Dyer in this chapter says that's what the ego. If you just believe that you're a physical being, then it makes sense. Life is about gathering stuff, getting stuff. But here Lao Tzu is saying heaven is eternal, pointing out that we're eternal. But if you think you're just physical, then you're going to be trying to get stuff, trying to avoid stuff. But if you're eternal, you can live beyond the ego. So if we're doing that, if we're living to constantly try to get stuff to fulfill us or to avoid things that we don't like, there's no room to be of service. There's not a lot of room to be giving, is it? Because it's all about ourselves. It's about trying to get. It's trying to about avoid. It's trying to control, trying to manipulate. Try to manipulate, control people, situations, so that they don't step on our stuff that we don't want to feel, or to try to get things the way we think they need to be in order to be happy and fulfilled. So there's no room to be of service because it's all about us trying to do that. Whereas the sage has discovered the principle that in being of service, your needs actually get met. The sage has understood that as an expression of the Tao or of Spirit of God, the happiness, the joy, the peace, the fulfillment that we're seeking is actually within us. I love that idea. I've loved that idea for 30 years. It makes so much sense. And the more we live it, the more we start to experience it. And when we do that, then now life is not about constantly trying to struggle to get things to be the way we want them to be or trying to avoid the things that we don't like. Now we're free to say, Spirit, what would you have me do? What is mine to do? Another way to say it is, how can I serve? How can I serve? I like what Michael Singer says. He says, how can I raise this present moment? How can I raise the moment that's in front of me? It might be a little smile to somebody. It might be a kind word. It might be a compliment. It might be taking on a project. Might be starting a new business. Who knows? It doesn't have to be a big thing. It's how can I raise the moment in front of me? And we all need to be reminded of that, don't we? Jesus had to remind his disciples of that. In the New Testament, they were fighting over which one of us is the greatest. Reminds me of Muhammad Ali. I am the greatest. They're fighting over who is the greatest. And the man had been teaching them that life is not about trying to be superior to other people. It's not about trying to get status and all this stuff. It's not what it's about. And yet his disciples didn't quite get it. And he told them, the greatest among you is the one who serves. He said, I am among you as one who serves. Living beyond the ego. Think of the freedom in that. You mean I don't have to run after this and run after that? I don't have to try to avoid this and avoid that? I can simply focus on lifting the moment in front of me? and my needs are going to get met. I can be of service. I don't have to constantly be in a struggle. Yes. That's what the sages are telling us, reminding us. It doesn't have to be a struggle. You can let the struggle go and start to, this is easier said than done, though, isn't it, folks? Easier said than done, because the challenge is the ego. The challenge is our psyche that thinks we need praise, thinks we need symbols of our importance, that thinks we need people's approval, that thinks we need to please other people and whatever, right? And all this stuff that we carry from the past, that we're constantly, I don't like this, I don't like that. When is it going to be fall? It was hot yesterday. You know, this is summer. I'm tired of summer. We've had enough summer. When's fall going to get here? I like the changing leaves. I want fall. Well, it's not fall. It was 80-some degrees yesterday. It's 80-some degrees. Enjoy the 80 degrees. You know what I mean? That's what the psyche is always doing. I don't like this. I like that. I want this. I want that. It's too cold. It's too hot. I don't, you know, on and on and on. Instead of, can I enjoy life as it is? Can I accept life as it is? And can I raise the moment in front of me? How can I be of service? Now, I'm going to highlight one thing that's said here because I think some of us need to hear, be reminded of this too. He says, something in here. Where did you go? Serve the needs of others, and all your own needs will be fulfilled. Oh, the sage puts himself last. Some of you were raised, I bet, God first, others second, myself last. I don't think he means that. I'm not interpreting it that way. Because if you put yourself last all the time, you end up resentful. Amen? You end up resentful. And that's not necessarily being a sage. That just might be a people pleaser. I got to say yes to everything if somebody asks of me. Yes, 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 yes. Why? Because I need their approval. I need to be liked. I don't want people upset with me. I get value and worth by doing all these things for everybody. And yet, not taking care of my health, not taking care, not eating properly, not getting exercise, not, you know, taking some time to rest, not getting enough sleep, because I'm putting myself last, 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 last. And I think a lot of women have been, grew up at a time where it was always, you got to do everything for everybody else, and not take care of yourself, right? How many of y'all experienced that growing up? Women particularly. I read something recently where she was saying, men have no problem taking care of themselves, their needs. You know, I don't know if that's true or not, but I think men can also get very much into work, 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 and go after the symbols of success and neglect the body as well. In fact, having stress-related illnesses is often a badge of, look how hard I work. If you're not sick from stress, you're not working hard enough. You're not committed. It's crazy. We should be committed for that. You know, he's not saying put that, I think he's saying put that human psyche. That is, I want this, I don't want that, I like this, I need this to be happy, I'm trying to avoid that. Make that last. You're not that. You're the consciousness that has a mind, that has emotions. That's who you are. You're that witness. You're not all that other stuff. Mishigas. You're not all that. That's not you. Put that human psyche stuff, that ego stuff, don't resist it. Don't repress it. But observe it. Oh, there she goes again. There he goes again, whining about blah, blah, blah. You know, you're looking at yourself. You're conditioning. But that's not you. So the sage puts that last. Jesus said, he who would follow me, let him take up his cross and follow me. Now, how many of y'all feel a ee when you hear that? Ee, take up your cross and follow me. Ee. I didn't hear that when I was growing up. I was raised Jewish. That was supposed to be funny. He wasn't saying you got to suffer. He wasn't saying you got to be crucified. You know, there were some monks years ago, many years ago, who actually made crosses and hauled them around the monastery. That's a little too literal interpretation for me. No, the cross is that human psyche. Let that stuff go. Don't resist it, but observe it. So there's a lot in this first verse. Instead of trying to change everything, want everything to be different, let's start enjoying what is. And that's no easy task. Enjoy what is presented to us and ask, how may I serve? Or how may I lift this moment? How can I make this moment better for others? Cool? Sound good? All right, verse 8, based on the chapter Living in the Flow. Lao Tzu says, the supreme good is like water, which nourishes all things without trying to. It flows to low places, loathed by all men. Therefore, it is like the Tao. Live in accordance with the nature of things. In dwelling, be close to the land. In meditation, go deep in the heart. In dealing with others, be gentle and kind. Stand by your word. Govern with equity. Be timely in choosing the right moment. One who lives in accordance with nature does not go against the way of things. He moves in harmony with the present moment, always knowing the truth of just what to do. That's beautiful, isn't it? 2,500 years ago. It's amazing to think people can write, have been writing such beautiful things for thousands of years. The Tao is giving of itself. It's flowing. It's nurturing. It's nourishing. That's its nature. It's like the sun that shines on the righteous and the unrighteous. Right? It's just giving of itself. It's always seeking to be a blessing to us. We've got to be open to it. We've got to be in the tune with it. It's always seeking to do that. That's how it is. I love what the Jesuit priest Teilhard de Chardin said, or was it Meister Eckhart? One of those great mystics said, I don't thank God for loving me because he can't help himself. That's how the Tao is. Giving of itself. Nurturing itself. And he's comparing it with water. You ever think about how much water is a part of our life? You ever think about that? I did when I doused myself yesterday and today by accident. We're 85% water. Our body is 75% water. Our brain is 85% water. That should explain a few things in this brain, huh? 85% water. 75% water in the body. Wow, we're mostly water. Mostly water. The Tao as water, which is energy, right? Everything is energy, is already a part of us. We're already just in the water, we're living in that Tao energy. And it nurtures us, and it's part of us in so many ways. I like how he says that it nourishes without trying to. The Tao nourishes without trying to. When we're centered in spirit, we nourish without trying to. I remember a story about Gandhi. They said that when he entered a room, people felt uplifted. They felt peace in the presence of Gandhi. Was he trying to be uplifting? No, he was being who he was. There's a scene in the New Testament where Jesus is on his way to heal a girl. His mind was centered in spirit. And it says there was a woman in the crowd who had a flow of blood for many years. And she touched the hem of Jesus' garment, and she was healed. What does that mean? The hem of Jesus' garment was his consciousness. He didn't even know until the woman had touched the hem of his garment that she was even there. He was so centered in God, in healing, that all she had to do was tune into his consciousness to touch the hem of his healing consciousness, and she was healed. Can you see how Jesus, being centered in God, didn't even have to know about her healing need, and she was healed? Emily Cady, who wrote that classic book, How I Use Truth and Lessons in Truth, she says that a person who takes time in the stillness, in prayer and meditation on a regular basis, will establish harmony in one's home. By centering yourself, we nourish others without even trying to. Without even trying to. There have been lives that have been saved by a smile. I met a woman in a girl in high school who said that a smile helped her so much at a down point in her life. Just a smile. I was in a grocery store once, and I saw someone from Unity, and naturally, you know, I gave her a hug. Yeah, this was pre-COVID, and she said, "You don't know." Weeks later, she said, "You don't know how much that hug meant to me at that time." Just don't know. We can nourish people without even trying. That's true nourishment. He goes on to say, live in accordance to the nature of things. In dealing with others, be gentle and kind. Do we need to be reminded to be gentle and kind in these days? It seems like we do. To be gentle and kind. Gentleness is not weakness. It's strength. It's self-control. It's tuned in to something other than the worldliness. It's thoughtful. It's giving, isn't it? Being kind, being gentle. It's not weakness. It's an insecure person. It's an afraid person. It's someone who is seeking power outside, who needs to threaten, needs to show power, needs to intimidate. Gentleness is someone who is secure within themselves. Gentleness, kindness, is, as he's saying, it's the nature of the Tao, and it's the nature of us as expressions of the Tao. Isn't that beautiful? That's the nature of us, to be gentle and kind. That doesn't mean we should be doormats, though. Dalai Lama said, kindness is my religion. Kindness is my religion. So Dr. Dyer says, and he, at the end of every chapter, he says, he has a point. Do the Tao now. Brown cow. He doesn't have the brown cow. Do the Tao now. And he says, next time you drink a glass of water, drink it quietly. And think about how the Tao, how water, like the Tao, nourishes you in so many areas of your life. Think about how water is so much a part of your life. We cleanse ourselves, we drink water, we're made of water. It's a part of us, just like the Tao is a part of us. And he said, think about how water nourishes you in so many areas of your life. And I think that's a great thought. And he says, I'll conclude with this. He says, one who lives in accordance with nature does not go against the way of things. He moves in harmony with the present moment, always knowing the truth of just what to do. The sages tell us that when we're living beyond the ego, when we're not seeking all the time to get stuff to make us happy, we're not spending our whole lives trying to avoid the things that make us upset. And he encourages us to be aware of when your ego is operating in your life. Dr. Dyer says, do an intensity scale of your ego during the day. I thought that's an interesting idea. Look at your ego operating during the day and label or scale its intensity. Is it a small ego desire? Is it low on the scale, or one or a two? Or is it a 9 or a 10? And what that little exercise does is it puts us in the seat of consciousness. It puts us in that observer state, doesn't it? Because now we're not caught up in it, we're observing it. And he gives the example of, for instance, let's say you're in a car and your partner or your spouse drives right past the parking space that you noticed and he or she didn't. What is the level of intensity that your ego wants to say something about that? Or you have an opportunity in a conversation to talk about some achievement or some award that you've received. What is the level of intensity of your ego to want to talk about that? I'd take it even a step further. When do we find ourselves wanting to complain about something? Or to be critical of somebody? Wow, we can be busy with this scale, can't we? But it's a good way to stand back and notice what we're experiencing, what we're feeling, so that we can, as Lao Tzu has told us, to live beyond the ego, to stop, to give, and Dyer actually encourages us to take a break, to be the witness of our life. As it says here, the sage is a witness of life. To be a witness of what's trying to unfold in our life. During this pandemic, I have a little note card in my kitchen, and it says something like, what's trying to happen? It says presence, and it says what's trying to happen. In other words, what is God trying to do? What is the harmony that's trying to happen? What is the right thing that's trying to happen? Give yourself a break from feeling like we've got to get this, get that, get this, get that, to be happy, to be fulfilled. I got to have the soulmate. I got to have the money. I got to have the car. I got to upgrade my apartment. I've got to get this. I've got to get that. I got to achieve that. I want this award. I want that. You know, all these things that go on, and I want to avoid these things that make me unhappy. I want to avoid this. And give yourself a break and make the commitment to start enjoying every aspect of life as it is. Oh, it's 82 degrees today. Great, wonderful. Oh, it's cold today. Oh, great, wonderful. Oh, this driver's going really slow. Oh, great, wonderful. Gives me an opportunity to tune into the present moment, to my inner patience. Oh, gee, that person was rude. Ah, good. That gives me an opportunity to see if I can rise above it and actually be kind in the face of their rudeness. Or, oh, good. This gives me an opportunity to define a boundary that needs to be created. So I'm not a doormat, and neither is anybody else. We can do that. We can choose how we want to think about stuff. And so that's our challenge to one another today, is to see how much we can start enjoying every moment of our life as it is today. That today is a great adventure. It's a great adventure. We've been given the gift of life today. This day is a gift. We don't know if we have tomorrow. I don't know that. You don't know that. But we have now, we have this moment, and we can, as the sage tells us, live in harmony with the moment so that we can know what to do in the moment and be of service in the moment. Can I enjoy this present moment, and can I raise this moment? Can I be of service in this moment somehow to make life better? That doesn't mean I say yes to everything anybody asks me. It doesn't mean I live and don't take care of myself and my own needs. It doesn't mean that. When you take care of yourself, you can be of greater benefit to others. You can only give what you have. If you're not healthy, if you're not strong, if you're not happy, then you don't have anything, you don't have a whole lot to give, right? If you only have two pennies, then someone asks you for a penny, you only have one to give them. You don't have a whole, you can only give what you have. So you got to take care of yourself, as the late Swami Satchidananda used to say. He said, take care of yourself so you can be of service. Nurture yourself so you can be of service. It all ties in together. Say no to this so you can say yes to that. Well, will you do this? I'm sorry, no, I can't do that because I have this that I'm doing. God is calling me to do this, you know. The lady was pouring ointment on Jesus' feet, and the disciples were upset by that. Why are you letting her put that expensive ointment on your feet? We could be feeding the poor. We could be taking care of the poor. And Jesus said, you will always have the poor among you. But I am with you now. There's always going to be more needs than we can fulfill. We've got to find what is ours to do. What in the moment in front of me is Spirit guiding and calling me to do? The late Stephen Covey used to say, the good is the enemy of the best. The good is the enemy of the best. You want to say yes to how Spirit is guiding you, and no to the things that are not yours to do. The sage lives beyond the ego, the psychic self, and lives more in a state of attunement with the Tao so that he or she can be giving to life, can be raising life, can be enjoying life, and all these things are added unto you. Let's get still for a moment. And we go forth this day knowing that we are in tune with the Spirit of God. We are in tune with the Tao that's guiding and directing us. We go forth this day knowing, making the intention and the commitment, I am going to enjoy every moment of this day. I'm going to enjoy, say that within yourself, I'm going to enjoy every moment of this day, and I'm going to raise the moment in front of me. I'm going to be of service to that which life gives me and shows me and guides me right here and right now. And I know and trust that all things are added unto me. Thank you, Father, Mother, God, for your timeless teaching, for your universal truth. And so it is. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. I wanted to mention also that I'm going to be doing a course on the first four verses of the Tao Te Ching. It's going to be a Zoom course, and it's going to be a hybrid. It's going to be in person, and it's going to be on Zoom, and we're going to go deeper into the first four verses of the Tao Te Ching, and we're going to be able to interact with each other in that course. So that's going to be, we'll give you more details. It's going to be on Wednesday, September 29th for 4 weeks, every Wednesday for 4 weeks. It'll be in person, and it'll also be a Zoom course. So look for the details of that very soon. All right. Thank you for our musicians today. Karen Drucker from California. Chanda Rule from Vienna, Austria. Thank you to them. And thank you for being here today. And let's join together in knowing the prayer for protection. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. God bless you. Namaste.